Are you able to hear me?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah.
Okay. Should we start?
Yes.
Yeah.
We'll just start with chanting Om three times. गुरु ब्रह्मा
गुरु ब्रह्मा
गुरु विष्णु
गुरु विष्णु गुरु देवो
महेश्वरः
महेश्वरः
गुरु साक्षात
गुरु साक्षात
परब्रह्मा
परब्रह्मा तस्मै श्री
गुरवे नमः
गुरुवे नमः।
Slowly open your eyes. Which is this recording?
Yeah. I'm just going to post a message that the class is going on because some people have joined, so that Mamta can also join it.
Okay, sure. After you post the message, we'll start.
Yeah.
So, Savita, how are you?
I'm good. Thank you so much. I'm good.
How are you spending time in the lockdown?
Mostly cleaning.
Cleaning.
Yeah. Otherwise, I have few things to do which I carry on doing. How have you been? Any more paintings of yours?
Not much time for painting. A lot of work through office. A lot of work.
So Mumta, the class is on because some people are joining.
Veena, you're not on video. It will be nice to see everybody so that that's when the flow comes.
Yeah, now.
So Mumta is joining.
Mumta is joining.
Yeah.
Just wait for Mumta. 2-3 months we'll be able to meet again if we are allowed to by law and if things have settled down. And by then we can do the last session, because the last session needs to be in person.
Sure.
This is already the 9th session, I guess. And we can have a few more online sessions in between, and then the last session in Vivek's office.
Sure.
There'll be a test in the last session, examination.
Oh my God, don't give me a nervous breakdown already, please.
Yeah, so you'll have to go through all the videos, Savita.
Okay, if it's just that, I'll do that.
No, I think no, most of the questions will be anyway out of syllabus.
It's always like that, no? With these things.
So what do you want to know today? What should we talk about today?
Give me one second. No, this is Savita back here.
Okay, so it's two Savitas. There were two Beenas, now two Savitas.
I don't know why, but my audio isn't working, so.
Which is the real one?
The one where we can see the fan running.
I think, Savita, you're on two video. Yeah, you can turn off one of them. Yeah, you can just close one, the phone one. Yeah.
So, okay, I think I'll close the laptop one because I don't have audio on that. So I'll just keep this.
Oh, is it okay? Sure.
It's okay. Just
leave.
It's fine.
I think I'll do phone this. In front of the laptop. Yeah. So, what should we talk about today?
I don't have any questions.
No question. That's very good.
Yeah, I'm in a good state of mind.
Questions are coming.
Yeah, they're slowly disappearing.
Very nice. Very good. Savita, any questions?
So I was just thinking if we claim, I mean, if I dissociate myself from the self, the hope and maybe that's the intent to lose out on everything that is associated with the self. Right? By dissociation, I mean to say. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so if I'm going to try and dissociate myself from the self,
I'm so sorry. I lost my internet for a second. You have to repeat the entire thing. I didn't hear it.
So I'm talking about dissociation from the self.
Dissociating from the self.
Yeah.
Okay. What is the question? I didn't understand. What is the question part of it?
How do we go about it, and why is it always connected to human emotions?
So can you frame the question again, rephrase the question?
So dissociating the human from the self.
Okay.
Why is it always associated with the emotion?
Okay. But who told you it's associated with the emotions?
What?
Who told you it's associated with the emotions?
because that is the only thing that I invariably seem to be fighting or trying to dissociate from.
From the emotions.
If I think about, yeah, mostly from emotions.
Okay. Okay. So the question is, how do I disassociate the human from the being? So we know we are called as human beings, right? So a human being has a human aspect, has a being aspect. So are you the human or are you the being? So this is the question.
I am the human.
So the question is, I'm a human being. And I neither understand the human part, I neither understand the being part, I'm neither human, nor am I, nor do I realize myself, recognize myself as a being. And I have, as a human, I have so many emotions, which most of the emotions, like what we say emotions in Sanskrit, are called as kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsarya. Okay, these are the emotions that disturb. We have the other emotions which are nice, you don't want to become free from that. The emotions that trouble you, you want to become free from. So how do I recognize my being? How do I, sorry?
Is it possible to free yourself from every emotion? That's what I'm saying. Why is it that struggle should it always be from negative emotions? Can it not be universally, unanimously with all emotions?
Yes, I got the question. And so we'll talk about that. So we'll start with the emotion aspect first. We'll address emotions. Then we'll talk about the human being. And we'll talk about the being. Are we still waiting for Mamata, Vivek, or should we start?
We can start. Mamata said she will log in. I'm not sure what's taking her so long.
Okay, so we'll start. Have you started the recording?
Yes, I have.
Okay, it's recording. All right.
Yeah.
My pranams to all. So we'll talk about emotions first. So the question that you asked was, how do I become free from emotions? All emotions. Is it required, first of all? Is it possible? All these things, we'll look at all these things. So what are emotions, first of all? Can you give me an example of emotion?
Anger.
Affection.
Love.
Anger.
Okay, so when we say emotion, generally, so we say, we use it in sentences like, this person got too emotional, they got too emotional watching a movie, they could not control their emotion. Somebody has, there's some death happened, somebody could not control their emotions. So we have heard of all this. And you also say, I become too emotional. And we also call anger as an emotion. Hate is an emotion, right? So let's take one example. Let's take anger as an example. So first thing you need to understand is, there are three different things. There is thought, feeling, and emotion. Okay, thought, feeling, emotion. What is thought?
Idea.
Thought is a movement in your mind. It is an idea. It could be an idea. It could be an image. It could be a sound. It's a still. It's a picture. I would say it's a frame. One frame. Okay. So it's one frame. Okay. To give an example, you see there's a boy standing in the bus stand. He sees a girl. The first time, it's a frame, one image, one thought. Oh, this is another person. This person is beautiful. Okay, one thought. When the thought repeats, the thought starts repeating, because the thought is either good or bad. You understand? So it's in both, in either of the cases, it repeats. Regardless if it's good or bad, it multiplies. So the frame now becomes movie. The picture now has become animation. And that animation, that moment of multiple thoughts, starts creating emotions. But there is something which is deeper than thought, which is called as a feeling. Okay? Feeling you can have, feeling is more biological. Thought doesn't have to have a connection with your biology. For example, when you are not feeling good in the body, when you have some disease, then you have when you start being emotional. Like somebody didn't have a cup of, they missed their first cup of coffee in the morning. Okay?
I haven't.
The entire day is ruined.
Yeah.
Okay? Do you understand that? You miss your first cup of coffee, your entire day is ruined. Not that somebody is coming and harming you. Even somebody's trying to come and talk to you, don't talk to me. You're irritated. Okay? Because you have an uneasy feeling biologically. That craving is not satisfied. Your biological craving of having that tea is not, or coffee is not satisfied. So feeling is very deep. So you have feeling as a human being. Then you have thoughts. Savita, are you able to hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah.
Okay, then you have thoughts. Thoughts come from the feeling. Breathing, feeling is the primary. Thought is the second. Thought and emotion is the secondary. Emotion sometimes overtakes the thought. You react and then the thought comes. Oh my God, I did this. So you have a bad feeling. Somebody comes and talks to you. Hey, don't talk to me. You shout at them. You react emotionally. And then in retrospect, you start thinking, I should not have done like that. So all these things happen. So feeling is the primary. From that, emotion and thought arise. Is this part clear? So our anger that we experience. So you say you became angry. The becoming angry is the emotional aspect. But it would have started as a feeling biologically in your body. That's why Gautama Buddha described the practice called Vipassana. There's a practice called Vipassana. Have you heard of it? Vipassana?
Mm-hmm.
So in Vipassana, for 10 days, you just sit observing your body. Nothing else to do. 10 days, you just observe the body. So Buddha said, you just go on observing the body. So it's very difficult. You start first layer of what happens is you start getting restless. Vipassana is very similar to lockdown.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, in Vipassana also they lock you down for 10 days, no talking to anybody, no looking at the eye into the eye of the other person. You will be given food. You go and meditate from 4 a.m. to 9 p.m. In the Vipassana practicing centers right now. But Buddha had prescribed the same thing. So it's similar to a lockdown where there's no, your external interaction is cut off. So what does the mind start doing there? You cannot, it starts playing with itself. You cannot talk to another human being. So you will start talking to yourself. Multiple personality syndrome. Okay, so what happens? You're closing your eyes and observing the body. Start feeling all your ideas, all the things I should do, starts coming first. Okay, just when you have the lockdown, you'll start thinking of all the things you could have done outside. You can't do it now. That's the first level. You sit through that because you're not able to do anything. You continue. Then you start feeling emotional. All the emotion starts coming out. And Buddha says, you go on to observe, you will see the emotion rising as a feeling in your body. It comes as a feeling, then that feeling becomes emotion. When you get angry, if you're aware, if you're a meditator, you will be able to locate the place of anger in the body, where the anger is arising from. So there's a disease called arthritis. Have you heard of arthritis?
Mm.
You know what is what the disease does?
Joint pains.
The disease affects the joints, the knee joints, on all the joints. The diseases are now scientifically, researchers have proven that they all are, most of them are psychosomatic.
Mm.
Meaning the emotional disturbances of the mind cause the diseases in the body. Arthritis is one of them. So when the emotion comes, why this happens is when there's a bad feeling in the body, then there's an emotion that comes out. When the emotion comes, emotion is nothing but motion. The energy is in motion. There's a surge of energy in the body. That's why in anger, you can, you know, punch somebody who is much stronger than you, or you can break something which normally you can't break. Okay? You will defy the laws of physics in anger. So, because the energy is moving so much. Now, the energy has two ways. Express or suppress. Emotion has two paths. You express. When do you express emotion? When do you express anger? In this case, anger. When the other is weaker to you. When you get angry with the boss, you can't express it. Okay? You suppress it. But when you get angry with somebody who's weaker than you, subordinate, child, or somebody who you think you can take on, you express. Now, both the paths are trouble. If you express the emotion, what happens? The anger.
You get fired.
You express the emotion, it creates either guilt or some other suffering. You experience the repercussions of that. The results come back to you. And that will again create more emotion. But if you don't express it, you suppress it, it hits the body. So all the diseases in the body are suppressed. You understand? So over a period of time, once it reaches a certain tipping point, the body says, you can't take it anymore. See, when you're young, the body takes it. As you start growing old, the body has already collected so many suppressed emotions. At some points, it tips off as diabetes, arthritis, cancer, all these things. Cancer especially is connected to suppressed emotions. So there was a very famous lady called, healer called Louise Hay.
Mm.
Have you heard of Louise Hay?
Mm.
Yeah, yeah.
So Louise Hay herself had cancer.
Yeah.
And she understood, she worked on herself. She had a very traumatic life, life of abuse and that all those emotions led to her cancer. And she understood that all this my body is going through is because of suppressed emotions. Basically, my mind has created the pain for my body. If my mind can create suffering for my body, my mind can also heal it. So she started this process of affirmations and self-healing. And with that, with her technique, with her process, she healed herself of cancer, one, of cancer. And she healed thousands of people without any medication. Savita? Are you able to
give me one second. You carry on. Don't stop. You carry on.
Okay. Are you following, Bina, Vivek?
Yeah.
So whatever happens to your body, diseases happen to your body, 99% of that is psychosomatic, meaning your mind is creating it. And Louise Hay was able to go so deep in her meditation research that she found out what kind of suppressed emotion causes what kind of disease. So if somebody came with a back problem, she would say your back problem is because of your fear of finances. Somebody who came with arthritis, you would say, okay, this is because of suppression of anger that you have done, where you could not express it. Somebody else was abused, some trauma, some memory that was in the past that happened, incident. That incident caused some other disease. So like this, she was able to figure out which emotion caused which disease.
Yeah.
Simply because of not expressing that. When you don't express this emotion, which is energy, emotion is nothing but energy. And you feel it also. It's not something that you're not aware of. Whenever you get angry, your body starts, you feel the fist stronger, the blood rushing.
Yeah.
Right. You feel like a bomb that can explode. You yourself feel combustible.
Yeah.
Right? That is because of the energy. The energy is in motion. Why is the energy in motion? Why is that happening? Why is the emotion rising?
It's feeding on those feelings.
The emotion rises because of repeated feeling and thought. So what Sri Krishna tells in the Bhagavad Gita is, he says in the second chapter, how does emotion rise and how do you become free from it and what they do? Shloka he says is, Yayato vishayan pumsaha sangas tveshopajayate sangat sanjayate kama kamat krododvijayate. Meaning, starting point is thought. You do window shopping. You see something one day. Okay, it doesn't make such an impact. You see it the second day, starts coming in your dream. Then you see it in the third day, you want it. Dhyayato vishyan pumsaha. You go on thinking about something. Dhyayato vishya. Dhyaya means thinking. Vishya. What is vishya?
Subject.
Content.
Okay. Vishya is visha. What is visha?
Poison.
Poison. You go on. So the teaching is all objects are poison. Vishya. There, whatever you can see as an object is vishaya. And repetition of thinking about them, your obsession of them, yayato vishayan tumsaha, sangasteshu bajaya. You start getting attached to them. For example, you're waiting in a you're waiting for in some office or somewhere. You're sitting in some place. Okay? You just take a toilet break and you come back, somebody else is sitting. What do you say? This is my seat, get up. So the sangha has already happened. The attachment to something that you're going to leave in half an hour has already happened because of interaction with it. So everything in the world you interact with, you become sangha, you get attached to. Even if it's for half an hour. See, the child plays with a toy. After that, he'll throw the toy. He'll never touch the toy again in his lifetime. But when it's playing, you try to separate that, it will create a ruckus. So the same thing happens to us. So we interact with the world and we start possessing it. For time being, you start possessing it. That is called sangha. You get attached to it. Sangha steshu bajayate. Sangha sanjayate kama. Because of that attachment, you have a desire to own it. Okay? And that desire doesn't get fulfilled, or it gets fulfilled, it doesn't get fulfilled. In either of the case, kamat krodho bijayate. The desire leads to anger. Is this process clear? Thought, attachment, desire, emotion. This attachment and desire is what is feeling. Thought, feeling, emotion. Not thought. Thought, repeated thought, feeling, emotion. This is the cycle. So if whenever you get angry, think about the last time you got angry. If you play back, you will be able to see the entire journey. Your anger is the emotion. It would be preceded by a feeling. The feeling will include desire and the sensation in the body. And that would be preceded by repeated thought. Clear so far, Savita? How emotions arise in us?
Yeah.
So all emotion. This is about anger. So I want something, I didn't get it, anger comes out. I want something, I got it, another emotion comes out. What is that emotion?
Fun.
Pride. I didn't get it, you get angry. I got it, pride. I didn't get it, somebody else got it, jealousy. I got it and I want more, greed. You understand the fractal? It's all I want only. It's all caused by I want. I want, I didn't get it, krodha. The kama leads to krodha. I want, I got it, madha. Right. I want, I didn't get it, somebody else got it, matsarya. This is jealousy. Kama, krodha, loba. Loba is moha. Moha is I want, I got it, I get attached to it. Then I want more of it. This loba. Greed. Kama, krodha, loba, moha, madha, matsarya. These are the six emotional disturbances that all human beings go through. And how they arise is by repeated thinking, and that repeated thinking creates feeling, that feeling creates emotion. The emotion has two parts, expression, suppression. When you express, you get into trouble. When you suppress, you get into deeper trouble. At least that expression trouble you come out of. Okay, someone 2 days, you'd come out of it. The suppression causes immense trouble. Once the natural order of the body is disturbed, it is very hard to bring it back. So you see, people doing so much circus to get rid of their diabetes or arthritis. One disease, like through deep disease, ruins life. This is the problem statement. Okay? Is the emotion part clear, Savita?
Yeah.
So do you experience all these emotions?
Every day.
Every day.
All of it.
So you're prone to diseases.
Yeah. I've always been.
So, the teaching helps us to come out of this. I'm telling you. So, the emotion I told has expression, suppression. But there is also a possibility for transcending. So expression, suppression, transfer. You can either express anger, you can either suppress anger, or you can transcend anger. Choice is yours. So based on what you want to do, I'll take up that direction. Savita?
No, you don't put me in a spot.
No, you are the one with the problem, no?
No, I'm sure it's everybody's problem.
How can you say? I don't have a problem.
Okay.
So, you can transcend emotion. That is the point of Atmagnana. The emotion is arising in you because of desire. Okay? The desire is arising in you because of a sense of incompleteness. Okay, for example, let's say the lockdown is going on and you have stocked up in your house enough to last 1 year. Okay, and you're all staying in an apartment, and their apartment, there's one grocery truck that comes, and they announce there's not going to be any grocery delivery for the next 1 month. You have enough for 1 year in your house, and you will start seeing people fighting and start snatching and beating up each other and everything. Will you involve in that?
No.
Why?
Because I have stuff at home, right?
Because you're adequate.
I have stuff. Yeah.
Because you have, correct?
Yeah.
Because you're abundant. Right?
Yeah.
So you do not crave, nor do you desire. The emotions arise out of craving and desire. Desire arises out of a sense of lacuna. I am incomplete. I need something else to be complete. This is the beginning of all human journey. The sense of incompleteness is what we lead our lives with. And our entire life is only about filling that sense of I am incomplete. So that's why you start. People say, I am incomplete. If I get a degree, if I get an education, I'll be complete. Then they get an education. Then they don't feel complete. And they say, okay, if I get a PhD, I'll be complete. Then they do another degree. So degrees after degrees, they start adding up to their name. As if the completion of the name becomes, only the page will get completed. Internally, nothing will get completed. So they try that, doesn't work out. Then they decide, okay, this degree is not helping me. If I get money, I'll be complete. So they start going after money. Then they get some money. Then they say, okay, this is also not helping. If I get married to another person, I'll be complete. Okay? Then they get married. Then instead of completion, there are two incomplete people. Instead of two, the idea was two incomplete people, two halves should make one whole. Instead of two halves making one whole, there are two halves. There are two bigger problems. First, there was only one problem. Now there are two problems. Okay? But originally, marriage is so that two incomplete people come together and become complete. But nobody is teaching us this. The two incomplete people come and make the incompleteness of the other people more obvious. The other person comes and showing your incompleteness to you. See, this person, my friend, is earning 3 lakh salary. You're only earning 1 lakh. My neighbor, they have one BMW. You don't have even one Maruti car. And the other person, they start saying, oh, my friend is so beautiful. You can't even get your eyebrows done. My mother cooks so well. You can't even cook one chapati properly. So you start bringing out the incompleteness of the other. Instead of completing the other, you are amplifying their incompleteness. So again, problem. Okay, then the person thinks, okay, degree didn't work out, money didn't work out, marriage didn't work out. They start going spiritual. I'm going to become spiritual. Okay, then they will go and join some ashram or do some yoga, some program. Then they'll start accumulating there. Then even there, they start feeling more incomplete. That master is enlightened. I am not enlightened. Person has done meditation for 10 years. I only started now. You understand? Wherever you go to try to fill your incompleteness, your incompleteness gets amplified and shown back to you. Have you encountered this in life, Vivek? Whatever you try to do in your life, whatever success you get, whatever accomplishment you get, doesn't change how you feel.
No.
Okay, it doesn't. Temporarily it gives some happiness.
Yeah.
And that happiness is so fickle, it can be shaken by the end of the day.
Yeah.
For example, somebody buys a new car, very happy taking the photograph in the showroom. Let's say they go out, some cycle wala just fractures or dents a little bit. That second, the happiness is gone.
Yeah.
And rage comes out. Okay. Why did that rage come out? My desire that nothing should happen to what I possess. I have a very strong desire that this is my new car. Nothing should happen to it. It's a very subtle, deep desire. That gets shaken. So if you see any anger that you feel at any point of time, behind that, there is an expectation of how the world should be that is getting disturbed. So Bina, when was the last time you got angry?
Yesterday itself.
Yesterday?
Yeah.
Okay, why did you get angry?
Again, it all comes down to expectations.
So that's an expectation which is not met.
Right.
So the parent becomes angry at the child because the child doesn't work within the framework that they have. Savita, is this clear?
Yeah.
So whenever you get angry, please understand that nobody is causing anger in you. There's nobody on the outside that is the cause. Who is the cause?
Self.
No. Self is different. Me and the self are different. Self is Brahman, Atman. Me, the mind has expectations. Your own expectations are causing you anger. So I'll tell you a story of the Buddha. Buddha and Ananda. Ananda was Buddha's close disciple. They used to go begging every day. And Buddha used to only beg once a day. Okay? And every time he had a rule that I will only beg once a day, one meal, and I will not go to the same house twice. And whenever I take food, I will give a teaching. So he will not take food just like that. He will teach, and he wants to cover as many houses. So he'd go to different houses each day. So one day they go to a house to beg. An old lady opens the door, and she looks at Buddha. Buddha is a prince. Very handsome, is very well built, he's a Kshatriya. She gets very angry and she scolds him that my son works hard, he earns for the family, he takes care of me, you are so fit, why can't you earn? And she scolds him and yells at him and she spits on his face. But Buddha is throughout, he's silent, listening to her, smile. When she spits on the face, he just wipes, he bows down. And he goes, he doesn't say anything. He's not at all disturbed. But Ananda, who is beside him, he's furious because Buddha is an enlightened master. He's like God. And he tells Buddha, why didn't you tell anything to her? You would have told her who you are. Buddha says, calm down. Okay. And they go and sit under a tree. There, Buddha has a begging bowl. Buddha gives the bowl to Ananda. He says, Ananda, throw away your bowl. Ananda throws his bowl. And he accepts the bowl that Buddha gave. Buddha asks him, whose is that bowl? Who does that bowl belong to now? So who does that bowl belong to now? Ananda. So Ananda says, it is mine. Buddha asks, why is it yours? Because you gave it to me and I accept it. Mine. Buddha says, okay, I give it to you and you don't accept it. Whose is it?
Buddha's.
Buddha's. So he says, the lady gave me the abuses. I didn't accept it. Why did you accept it? Whatever she said was because of her. It has nothing to do with me. Ananda resonated with that because he already has a predisposition of anger in him and desire in him. Buddha has no trace of any desire in him. Buddha has become desireless. There is no desire that I am a Buddha, people should respect me. That is why, you know, most of the people, the worst hurt you can give is disrespect. They're okay with you break something in their house, is fine. But you speak harshly to them, they get immensely hurt. That is unforgiven, unforgivable. Okay? Because they have a sense that I am this person. And nobody should talk to me like this. It is a desire. I am a respectable person in this society. And that thought gets disturbed. And that's why the anger comes. Buddha has no, he's become free from even that. All identities, freedom from everything. There is nothing in Buddha that can be shaken to cause anger. But there was something in Ananda. You understand? The cause of anger is not Buddha. The cause of anger is that lady, what she is carrying. You understand what I'm trying to say? Whenever you get angry, nobody can make you angry if anger is not there in you. Nobody can create hate if hate is not there in you. Nobody can create jealousy if jealousy is already not there in you.
But Murli, isn't it obvious and natural that emotions are present?
Yeah, so emotions are natural. Is that true?
I think it is.
Emotions are the most unnatural programmed behavior. Emotions are programmed behavior. If you are brought up in an environment without emotional disturbances exhibited or you're aware of, your ability to respond like that is not there. For example, in a street, there's something happening in the street, like a road rage or something. You listen to the words that are spoken by the people in anger. It is all the words that you will always hear. The dialogues are the same dialogues. Have you heard any new dialogue?
Mm-hmm.
In anger, do you hear any innovative, spontaneous new dialogues? The parents have a set of dialogues, same dialogues. Mera aulad, what is that? Khandan ka naam mita diya, or no, same thing. Same dialogue, whatever they've learned from TV, from stories. Okay, the children have same dialogues. You are all old generation, you don't understand. Okay, leave me alone. I have my own life. I am independent. Same dialogues. Where did the dialogue come? Peer programming. All the dialogues are already, you're programmed from somewhere. This is This is very, very clearly seen in children, especially if you are interacting with children, you go and see. Whenever a child is fighting, no, they speak the language that they've heard. Either the abuses that their father or mother is speaking, or the one that they've heard from their favorite hero. What I'm trying to say is, whenever you express anger, you're basically a TikToker. Some dialogue you're repeating and doing some movement. You understand? The dialogue is already there. You see, in your anger, you cannot think of innovative things to tell. You can really hurt the person if you want to. If you are intelligent enough, you know which aspect of the life you can hurt. But you don't do that. You say something stupid. You call them names. Very, very superficial. You understand? So when you're overcome by emotion, your thinking faculty is shut down. Okay? So coming back to the point, what I was trying to say was the emotion is unnatural. Emotion is programming. And emotion is programming because, emotion unnatural because it comes from a false sense of incompleteness. We were talking about incomplete. You have a sense of incompleteness that you're trying to fill yourself. You're trying to become complete. That incompleteness is the cause of suffering, emotion, desire in your life. So spirituality addresses this incompleteness. So can we start the topic of incompleteness now? So far, are you clear? Emotion, feeling, programming of emotion, and desire, incompleteness. How we live our life, how anything that you do in your life is to just that, get that sense of completeness. So far, clear? Savita, clear?
Yeah. Is this getting recorded? I'm sorry.
Yeah, it is.
Can I reach for it later? I'm sorry.
No problem. So I'll continue with the incompleteness. You can watch the incompleteness part later.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So others, are we? Shall we continue?
Yeah.
So there's a beautiful shloka in Sanatana Dharma. You can repeat after me. Om Purnamadaha
Purnamadaha
Purnamidam
Purnamidam
Purnat
Purnat
Purnamudachyate
Purnamudachyate
Purnasya
Purnasya
Purnamadaya
Purnamadaya
Purnameva
Purnameva
Vashishyate
Vashishyate.
So it means Purnamadaha. Purna means complete. Purnam Adaha. Ada means that. Brahman is, it says Brahman is complete. That is complete. God is complete. Purnamidam. This world is complete. Purnamadaha, Purnamidam. Purnat Purnamudhichate. From that complete came this complete. Where did the world come from? The world is complete. It came from the complete called Bhagwan. That is also complete. This is also complete. Purnamadaha, Purnamidam. Purnat Purnamudhichate. Purnasya Purnamadaya. If you take out the completeness, complete from this complete, what remains is complete. A very tricky shloka. Is complete, that is whole, this is whole, that this whole came from that whole. If you remove this whole, if you remove the whole from the whole, what remains is whole. In all this whole, I am incomplete. In this complete universe, the only thing incomplete is who?
Me.
But how can that be? That is complete. This is complete. There's no such thing as incomplete universe. Everything is complete and perfect. There is no imperfection in the creation of Bhagwan. Is it true? Do you see imperfection in the world?
Not in nature, but yeah, in the current world.
So we see imperfection everywhere.
Yeah.
For us, from a human mind's perspective, everything is imperfect. God himself is imperfect.
Yeah.
Right? We are like, what kind of a God creates such suffering in the world? Yeah. If I were a God, I would do a much better job. What kind of a God would create my child like this? What kind of a God would create such less salary like this for me? If given a choice, we would like to change everything. Okay, but to give you the example, just close your eyes. Visualize your house, the house that you stay in. And see what all you'd like to change there. Your house, its people in the house, beings in the house, and also your own body. You can look at and see what all you want to change, what all you would like to change. Okay, open your eyes. So, Bina, what all you like to change?
A lot of things. I mean,
lot of
things. I never thought that I would get so many in the list.
Vivek, would you like to change anything?
A lot of things. I'm actually in the process. That's what, like, I want to change to wooden floor.
Okay.
I want to move my dining table to a different area.
Lot of things. Okay, now close your eyes again. Close your eyes again. And visualize a scenery, maybe a mountain. The ocean, mountain, forest. Scenery, maybe you've been there, some natural location that you've been to, or you've seen in a picture. And see what you'd like to change there.
Nothing.
Open eyes. Huh?
Nothing. Just perfect.
Perfect. Now, you are also part of that creation. You are also idam. You are part idam, part adam. Part this and part that. How can you be incomplete? So, there is it's a nice story of Mullah Nasruddin. There was a guy called Mullah Nasruddin. He was telling, he was teaching in his village, and he was telling everything in God's creation is perfect. There's nothing imperfect in the world. Then there was this guy, Kubuda, a handicapped person. He comes and says, what nonsense are you talking? All this is garbage. Look at me. Everybody's fine. I'm the only handicapped person in the village. I am so imperfect. How can you say God's creation is perfect? Mullah says, you are also perfect. I have never seen a perfect handicapped person like you. Everything in God's creation is perfect. If there is a criminal, you're a perfect criminal. If there is a saint, perfect saint. If there's a Buddha, perfect Buddha. If there's a Rama, the Rama is perfect. If there's a Ravana, this Ravana is perfect. Okay, but without a perfect Ravana, how can the Rama's perfection come out? Without the perfect poverty, how can the aspiration to wealth come out? All the problems are perfect problems. Okay, so nothing is imperfect in the universe. But the human mind has its own idea of perfection. It says that this has to be like this. That is the problem. I have to be like this. I have to look like this. I have to be treated like this. I have to possess like this. I have to be given like this. I have to know like this. I have to not experience suffering like this. The suffering that you experience, the thoughts that you experience are perfect. The day you accept everything as perfectness and complete, you become free. You feel incomplete because you don't embrace the wholeness or completeness of life. And the sense of incompleteness is a false sense. Okay? There is nothing incomplete in the universe, including you. You feel I'm incomplete. That is because you associate with the body. But even the body itself is actually perfect and complete. There is nothing incomplete or imperfect in the universe because it's Purnamada, Purnamidam. And even if you remove it, what remains is Purna. Purna, Purnamidam. Purnasya, Purnamadaya, Purnameva, Vashishvati. But in this whole complete universe, I am feeling incomplete. And that is only a matter of feeling. That feeling is arising because of lack of Atma Gnana. Why is that feeling arising?
Lack of awareness.
Lack of awareness of your true self as awareness. You are awareness itself. And that awareness itself is called Brahman. That's why it says Prajnanam Brahma. The quality of the reality of Brahman is awareness. You are the one that is aware of completeness and incomplete. Because you are beyond both. You are awareness. You understand what I'm trying to say? Vivek?
Yeah.
You can become aware of the perfection and completeness. You can become aware of the imperfection and incompleteness. But you can never be aware of lack of awareness, lack of your own existence. There is never a point in your life where you can not exist and be aware of it. You understand? You are aware of everything. You're aware of the waking, the dreaming, the deep sleep. You're aware of the cravings, the desire, the having, the not having. You're aware of the changing of the body, the dream. You're aware of the dissolution of the dream. You're aware of the dreamless state, the deep sleep state. The absence of your body and the mind, absence of craving. You are aware of both craving and the absence of craving in your deep sleep. You are aware of your absence of craving and absence of all desires, Veena?
Yeah.
You are aware of both because you're beyond. But you associate yourself something which is not awareness, which is the body and mind. And this false association is called avidya. Okay? The false association with what I am not causes feeling that I am incomplete. Give this example in your own life. As a baby, you didn't have this. Because you were not associated with anything yet. That's why you were in a state of Sachidananda. That's why we in this country we call babies as gods. Bachcha Bhagwan hai. Kyun? Kyunki wo Sachidanand Swarup mein hai. The child has no sense of incomplete. Feels complete. Feels connected. But later, the child starts getting programmed. You are only this much. Then the child starts feeling the sense of, what did I tell you? Repetition of thought process. The repeated thought starts coming in the child. I am this body, I am this body, I am this body. Okay? Because people are also dealing with me as the body. Then, when you are the body, when you are this, desire comes. What is the primordial desire of the child?
Yeah.
No. Milk. The milk from the mother. The child seeks. There is no seeking of the milk, actually. The seeking of the milk has not, the desire has not arisen because the desire, there is love. The mother loves the child. Correct? The mother knows when to give the milk. And even if there's some time gap, the child cries a little bit, but it's not intense. There is no seeking in the child at all if the child is loved. The moment the child doesn't get milk, the child starts seeking milk. Child starts seeking love. That is the beginning of desire. The child starts seeking love and object. It actually seeks love. If the child is loved, it's ambushed or overflown, the child is embraced and it's loved a lot. You see, you have to force the child to drink the milk, eat food. When children are loved, you have to force them to eat. Baby has to be forced because it's already filled with love. It doesn't need anything. When the child is unloved, it starts craving more. It starts crying more. Because lack of love means what? Tomorrow I might not get milk. There's a fear. Lack of love brings fear in the child. Tomorrow, there's no guarantee I'll get milk. So it wants to hold. You understand? Child seeks love when it's not given love, and it seeks object, which is milk. That same thing starts growing. Now, how can you be? Of course, most of us are loved, and most of us are fed well also. But slowly that love starts getting diluted. It starts becoming conditioned love. It starts growing and the parents start treating it differently. First, they were unconditionally loving it when it was a baby. Now it's 2 years old. The condition is put. Do like this, then I give it to you. If you do like this, if you behave like this, you won't get it. They start shouting, they start showing hand, they start threatening. All these starts affecting the child, and the child starts to mold itself. And that molding starts because lack of love and formation of identity that I am this and I am imperfect. Because constantly somebody is asking me to change myself. Constantly the parent is saying, do this, eat this, don't eat this. That's why a child puts anything into a mouth. It puts food into the mouth, it puts shit into the mouth, it puts mud into the mouth. And the parent comes in and says, don't eat this, don't go there. This will come, the demon will come, the ghost will come. Right? Don't, vahamajjana, don't go into darkness, don't touch that. So there is sort of your infinite nature starts getting programmed to a finite nature. And that is called as avidya. But fortunately, in ancient Indian Gurukul system, a child was sent to the master's house at a very young age, at the age of three or four. Okay? And even in the house, the child was brought up with Shravana of Atmagna, the listening of I am not the body, I am not the mind, I am Brahman. Then the child goes to Gurukul, where the Guru reinforces, you are not the body, you are not the mind, you are Brahman. That is what the child learns Vedas, the child learns Upanishads, the child learns Atmagnana, Bhagavad Gita. All this the child learns at a very young age. So Bhagavad Gita is actually the manual for the child. It's a user manual. Imagine you bring a new washing machine to the house, high-end new technology. The entire user manual is in Chinese. What will happen to the washing machine? And there are a lot of buttons on the washing machine. What happens, Vivek?
I'll start experimenting with it.
You'll start experimenting.
Yeah.
And sometimes there'll be trial and error.
Yeah.
Okay. But in the trial and error, you start damaging the system.
Yeah.
So our body and mind is the machine that is billion times more complex than any technology that we have. You put an apple into the body, the body converts that into blood and bone and flesh and cell. Which machine on the planet can do that? I put an apple into a machine, blood comes out. I put something dead into a machine, something living comes out. The body is practically doing that. Put anything dead into the body, it becomes living, it becomes you. It becomes cells. The body is a very complex machine, and the mind is much more complex than the body. Where is the user manual for that? That user manual is called Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is the user manual for your body and mind, because it has all that is required to lead your life from birth to death, to marriage, to war, to peace, to all your careers that you'll have, to children. Every aspect of life is looked at. Every role of life is looked at. Okay? The universal text. It applies to anybody in any place in the world, because it doesn't impose anything external. It's only an inquiry into the internal. Get it? So the child is given Atmagnana. Then there is no, it can retain its sense of completeness. But because of the modern day education, modern life, that stream of teaching of the self got cut. And we grow up looking at ourselves through the eyes of a million people. Okay? We constantly look at ourselves as what this person is thinking about me. And you try to mold, you try to fit in. Our entire life is only trying to fit in. Okay? Fit in there, fit in here, fit in either with human beings or fit in with animals. After some time, people will start figuring out, okay, I can't fit in with human beings. I'll fit in with animals. There also you don't fit in. They also don't accept you. Then you are nowhere, neither here, neither there. So what do I do? We are like Mowgli. Doesn't fit in with the village, it doesn't fit in with the wolves. Do you fit in anywhere?
No, I don't. But it does not matter.
Wherever you fit in, if you do fit in somewhere, it means that you've started cheating yourself. You have let go of your true nature and pretending to be something else. Any place where people fit in is place of killing off the original. They are only actors. They're only masks. And that is why we say satsang. Satsang is a place where all masks are removed. A real satsang is some place. It's called satsang. Satya, truth. Our only focus is truth. Our true face has to be revealed. And satsang is when there's a master who is not wearing any mask. The Buddha is wearing no mask, not even a mask of a Buddha. He doesn't even wear a mask of a guru. Because when you wear a mask of a guru, you have expectation. The disciple should bow down to my feet. The master, the Sadguru, has no expectation. You come, you don't come. You bow down, you don't bow down. You spit, you scold, you do anything. It doesn't matter. As long as you are inquiring into the truth. That's why in all the places of true satsang, there is no encouragement of any sort of unnatural behavior. And such an environment is usually a very private environment and quite a challenging environment. Because here nobody is boosting your ego. Master is not telling, oh my God, you're such a great disciple, you've done 10,000 hours of meditation. No. The real master will tell, what nonsense are you doing? What meditation? To know the self, should you do any meditation? So no pampering of the ego is done. That's why Osho used to say, to be with the Sadguru is a very, very difficult experience. There are gurus in the world, there are teachers, the unenlightened teachers. To be with them is very nice because they will empower you, they will praise you, they will give you credit, they will keep you on a pedestal. To be with a Sadguru, Sadguru will strip you completely, you know, be harsh to you. Do what is required to kill your ego. In other places, your ego is pampered. Wherever you see a lot of people, please understand that place is where ego is pampered. So people are going there because the natural tendency of the human being is to expand the ego, expand myself. Wherever you are starting to get killed and questioned, you run away. So Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had barely a handful of disciples, countable in your fingers. Jesus had four or five. Okay. Very few. Ramana Maharshi had barely just visiting disciples. And some people used to stay. So with the Sadguru, very few people will always be there. Because your ego is going to get very hurt. And it is eventually going to get destroyed. This is the process of enlightenment. That's why Shankaracharya said, satsangatve nisangatvam. From satsanga comes real detachment. Start attaching yourself to atmagnana is when you start detaching yourself from the world. That is called sannyas. Sannyas doesn't mean the dress of sannyas. Sannyas means attachment to the Bhagwan and detachment from the world. Not leaving the world. Embracing the Bhagwan in the world, embracing the perfection of the world, embracing the completeness of everything and everybody. So the teaching is, you are Purna, because whatever comes out of Bhagwan is Bhagwan. Like you are born to your parents, right? You inherit their biology, you inherit their psychology. To some extent. In the same way, whatever comes out of Bhagwan inherits Bhagwan, is Bhagwan itself in different form. It's like whatever is made out of gold, there is gold, pure gold, and some impurity added to the gold, because pure gold cannot be molded into different forms and shapes. They add some impurity. That some impurity is the avidya, because of some impurity, you start thinking you are the necklace, forgetting you are the gold. You understand?
Mm.
But without that impurity, the world doesn't run.
Mm.
The question, why the impurity? Is because that if that impurity is not there, Bhagavan is in a pure state. There is no movement. There is no creation. Creation happened when Bhagavan thought, okay, what if there was something apart from me? It was only a what if. There was never an actual manifestation. In only the thought of what if, see what we see. So right now, at this very moment, you are living in the what if there was something apart from me. That thought of Bhagavan. And that one thought of Bhagavan is the million years of human being. The world, there can never be anything apart from God, consciousness. It's only a thought, an imagination. And in that imagination, the world is seen. There is nothing apart from the whole. That is whole, that is complete. This is also complete. And you are, when I say you, the body and mind is part of idam, the world. And the consciousness is part of Brahman. You understand this part? The body and the mind belongs to the nature, part of idam. And it is perfect, it is whole. Whenever the body goes through anything, it is perfect for that body to go through at that time. It is the mechanism of the body to heal itself. Okay? When the body can't handle certain level of toxin, it starts throwing out in terms of disease. When the body can't handle a certain level of threshold of pain, it shuts down. You know that? You can't infinitely experience pain. You can't be tortured infinitely. After a certain threshold of pain, your body shuts itself down. You become unconscious. The body has an inbuilt mechanism to protect the body. And that way to protect the body is super intelligent, beyond human understanding. The body knows exactly what to do to itself because it's intelligent and it's part of idam. Okay? And the mind is part of, what? Body is part of that vision that you had, right? When you imagine the nature, no? That picture, that nature, that is called Ishvara Srishti, God's creation. Body is part of that. The mind is part of what you did when you close your eyes and thought about your room. That is called Jiva Srishti. Mind is part of individual society consciousness. All of that, nothing but garbage and recycling of garbage.
Mm.
You see in the world, time and again, society just recycles itself. Same dialogues, same aspirations. Any house you go to, same kind of thought patterns. Everybody's thinking about themselves. Okay? Go into any corporate place. Every single person has the same trajectory, vision for themselves, emotions, speaking of more money, everybody wants to get a best performer award, same thing. Go into a spiritual institution, everybody is seeking the same thing. Everybody wants people to touch their feet. Everybody wants people to tell you are Mahatma. It's the same game. Go into the tech circle. Everybody wants to solve the biggest problem. Everybody wants to be the next Facebook. Everybody wants to be the next Instagram. Everybody wants to be the next prime minister.
Mm.
You're just copy-pasting. Society is nothing. Mind is nothing but copy-paste. Mind only plays with past and future. And copy-paste it. Copy-paste, copy-paste, copy-paste. That's why you'll see in your life, no matter what changes in your life, your internal state doesn't change. because you continue to copy paste. Okay. A beggar becomes a billionaire. He will live as a beggar in a billionaire's body. Okay, and soon become beggar again. You understand? It's the same that is going on. So the mind is part of society. The body is part of Ishwar Srishti. You, the awareness, the one who is aware of these both, are a part, not a part, are the whole itself, tending to be a part. The whole, the Shiva, the whole is called Brahman or Shiva. Shiva becomes Jiva, meaning the whole pretends to be a part to experience the world as a, to experience the world. That is the only way Brahman can experience the world, when it embodies as a Jiva. So you are nothing but a vessel for God to experience the world. And whatever is experienced, the dream. You are taking the dream too seriously, and you're taking the role too seriously. That's why you become emotional. You see that in movies, when you go to watch a movie, no? People start crying. Maybe you cry or some people start crying. Why are those people crying? Don't they know it's just a movie? Veena, why are they crying?
I think they are getting too attached to the characters or too involved.
Getting too involved. That is the same thing that you are doing. You're getting too involved as Veena. That's why you get hurt when somebody talks about Veena. Or you get burdened when somebody has expectations from Veena. You are not Veena. Okay? You are the one who is aware of being Veena. That awareness is called Brahman. That awareness is called Sachit Ananda. That awareness is complete. You are by nature complete. To recognize yourself as complete is the end of, that's the only way you'll become complete. You will only become complete by recognizing you're complete. You will never become complete by anything, getting anything outside. You will never become complete by marrying somebody. You will never become complete by getting more money. You will never become complete by getting anything will never make you complete. Dropping the false notion that you're incomplete alone will make you complete. Vivek, any doubt?
Mm-hmm. Not at the moment, but when it starts to maybe sink in, then I'll have
some. It's not synced in? Was not clear?
No, sir. Right now, it seems everything is clear. And when I contemplate, then some questions starts to come up. At that very moment, there are no questions.
So the emotions that we started the discussion with, the emotions arise because of this sense of false sense of incompleteness and falseness sense of I am something. So the Buddha has become free from emotion because no sense of incompleteness and no holding on to any identity, including the identity of a Buddha or enlightened one. If he holds on to the identity that I am Buddha, and the moment his student doesn't get enlightened, understand, he gets angry. So the enlightenment means becoming free from all identities, including the identity I am Brahman or I am enlightened. You start holding on to that, that again will trap you. Be free from all traps, including the trap of enlightenment and guru. to repeated thoughts. Repeated thoughts create feeling. Feeling create emotion. When the emotion arrives, you are aware, you are conscious, you will be able to see this entire process happening. And seeing this entire process is transcending it. I told you can express emotion or suppress emotion or transcend emotion. How do you transcend emotion? You transcend by jnana, by seeing it. And the seeing doesn't happen through physical eyes. Seeing happens through the third eye, what's called jnana chakshu. You see, meaning you recollect this teaching. Then you observe yourself. Then you will see how, what is causing the emotional disturbance. It's not the other person. The other person is a trigger. You could have got triggered as much by a dog or a wall. Have you seen, have you observed that even like a pen falling down from the table can cause anger? The pen didn't cause the anger. You were already angry and that just triggered it. The external is only a trigger. Sometimes you need a trigger, sometimes you don't need a trigger to get angry. The anger is there inside you and it rises because of this process. The more you meditate, you become, you get command over this process. Jnana is so that you get command over feeling, emotion and thought. So what will happen is, through meditation, you will get the ability to stop the feeling at a feeling level by observing it. When I say stop, not, you know, put some force, just by becoming aware of the feeling, you've taken your attention to the feeling, then emotion doesn't rise. But after the emotion has already come out, you can't do anything. It's already come out. Once the arrow is shot, you can't retract it. But you can stop taking the next arrow, and if the arrow is already taken and placed on the bow, you can stop releasing it and not release it, put it back. That is the power Dhyana gives. So this is the journey. The journey is not you'll just throw away all your arrows. The journey is the anger will rise. Enlightenment doesn't mean that anger will never rise. Anger will rise. The anger will fall immediately. Because you will not give it importance. You have become a witness of the anger. In a natural scenario, you have become the anger. You have embraced it. Now you say, oh, anger is coming from feeling. Feeling is coming from thought. What is coming from? Where is thought coming from? Emotion is coming from feeling. Mm-hmm. Feeling coming from repeated thought. Repeated thought coming from thought. Where is thought coming from?
That's that frame, the first frame.
Where does the first frame come from?
Observation.
First frame comes from the first frame. Thought itself is arising because there is a sense that there is something other than me. Thought arises in Bhagwan when Bhagwan assumes there is some, what if there is something other than me? In reality, there is nothing. Thought arises in you because of the sense of incompleteness. That's why when you become complete, all you become thoughtless, nirvikalpa. It's called nirvikalpa, nirvikalpa samadhi. In nirvikalpa samadhi, no thought arises. Because why should, what is the motivation for the thought to arise? Thought arises because something has to move. Something, there's some thought creates time. Thought creates space. Space is a thought in your head. Time is a thought in your head. Thought is a wave in consciousness. Like how waves arise in the ocean. Thought arises in the individual consciousness. When the individual realizes he is the water, Shiva, thoughts cease to arise. what that squad is called, Nirvikalpa Samadhi. No more kalpa, no more kalpane. Kalpane means imagination. Because every thought is nothing but imagination. Because there is no reality apart from Brahman, and Brahman cannot be thought about. Brahman is beyond thought. Brahman is awareness. You cannot think about awareness. You can be aware of the thought. Thought is in the front. You cannot think about awareness. You cannot think about yourself, the true self. You can know the thought, but you can never know yourself. You can know the absence of everything else. You are the one who is, you are the presence or the witness. Whatever you see, thought is also you see, no? You see, you know the thought has come. Knowing is seeing, right? The thought comes, you know the thought. You know always what is not you. You can never know yourself. You can only be yourself. To know yourself is equal to being yourself. That's why it's called Brahma vid Brahmaiva bhavati. To know Brahman is to be Brahman. Okay? Whatever is seen, whatever is known, the dream. Not real. It's not you. Khule aankh se apne dekhe, band aankh se apne. Sapne dikhte hain bahar, bhitar dikhne dikhte apne. Whatever is seen with the eyes, khule aankh se, sapne, the sapna. Whatever you see. And whatever you seek also, with the eyes see, is sapna. You'll never get it. So sapne mein dikhta sab kuch hai, but you can't get anything. You see everything, but you can't get anything. You can't really catch it. You see wealth, you can't catch it. The moment you catch it, it becomes less. Have you observed? You seek wealth. The moment you catch it, it becomes less. It becomes inadequate. You need more. The moment you catch anything, the moment you catch a husband or a wife, they become less. You need more than that now. So, khule aankh se sapne dekhe. Whatever you see with your eyes open are sapna. Band aankh se apne. With the closed eyes, you see the self. You know yourself. You are the self. Because you are now cut off. Aankhon se dikhte. सपने दिखते हैं बाहर भीतर से अप. यू वॉन्ट टू फाइंड द इनफिनाइट हैप्पीनेस एंड द कंप्लीटनेस, यू हैव टू गो इनसाइड, स्टॉप योर जर्नी आउटसाइड. दैट इज द कंक्लूजन. शैल वी स्टॉप हियर? इट्स 1 o'clock. एनी डाउट सो फार?
नथिंग एट द moment.
Was the clarity, was it clear, this aspect of emotion,
yeah,
feeling, thought?
Yeah.
Okay, completeness, incompleteness, is it clear?
Yeah, it is clear.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want to meditate or do you want to just close?
No, I'm fine with anything.
Bina?
Yeah, a few minutes of meditation.
Okay, so we'll do just a few minutes of meditation. Close your eyes. Take 3 deep breaths. Relax. Become aware of the room that you are sitting in. aware of the room, space inside the room, space around you. Become aware of the space. Become aware of your body now and the space within your body. Body is filled with space. Become aware of the inner space now. Space within the body. Your entire body is filled with space. Become aware of the space in the heart center. Take your awareness to the center of your chest, the heart center, which is where you experience your emotions, which is where the emotions arise, the emotional disturbances are felt, which is also where you experience your feeling of I am. Feeling of I am arises from the heart center. The heart center is the center of Brahman. Your awareness gives rise to feeling of I am. Just hold on to the feeling, your feeling of just I am. Feeling that I exist, your unconditional existence. You are your unconditional existence. And you feel it in the heart center. Sit with the awareness of your unconditional existence. का समस्ता इनो भवन्तो लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु लोका समस्ता सुखिनो भवन्तु हरिः ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम Slowly open your eyes. Okay. Are you able to sit peacefully, Veena? Vivek?
Yes.
Were there thoughts?
No, there were none.
So the more you spend time in nirvikalpa, this is called nirvikalpa samadhi. Okay? Thoughtlessness, pure thoughtless awareness, which is your true nature. The more you spend time in it, the less you will start get affecting by the dreams, and the dreams stop getting created or multiplying. The more you'll start retaining the awareness even when you're interacting with the world. Slowly, all the unnecessary thought patterns will die. So when the internal dies, when the internal thought patterns die, their external manifestation also dies. What you experience outside is only what you carry inside. So when you become free internally, externally also, those problems or whatever, they get resolved and they disappear. Only everything unnecessary disappears from life. Okay. We will close.
Sure.
Thank you. See you next time.
Thank you. See you next time. I'll share the recording when the recording gets ready.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Yeah. Bye.